When I was in high school in the 1970s, there was one sentence in the middle of a paragraph in my American history book about it. And it was kind of, as I remember, a passive voice kind of sentence, like, they also gave women the right to vote, or women also got the right to vote. And I remember that the teacher didn't say anything about it, and that I didn't know that women hadn't always voted. You know, that both of my parents voted. One of my earliest memories is going to vote with my mother. Back when they did it, you actually had to vote by hand. And I think this was President Kennedy, when I think about how old I was at the time. Because I remember asking her who she'd voted for, and she said, she got really serious, and she said, Jane, you never have to tell anybody who you vote for. And I think, thinking back, I think she didn't want me to tell my dad that she'd voted for Kennedy. But I'm not positive. This is a piece of our history that, for some reason, we don't know. And particularly the piece I'm going to talk about today, we really don't know about it. It's not kind of, for some reason, part of a lot of people's historical memory. We could start our story way back. We could start way, way back. We could start with Abigail Adams asking John Adams to remember the ladies, as she put it, in the Declaration of Independence and the documents that founded our country, the Constitution. We could start with Mary Wollstonecraft. We could start with lots and lots of people. But we can also start with 1848, which is the first women's rights convention in the U.S. at Seneca Falls in upstate New York, organized by Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Lucretia Mott, and some other people. These women were in the abolitionist movement. They were trying to end slavery. And they had been to an abolitionist convention and were not seated, could not sit down and take part because they were women. And they thought, well, this is really kind of hypocritical and kind of wrong. And they set out to do something about it. They organized a convention in Seneca Falls, which was Elizabeth Cady Stanton lived around in that area, upstate New York. And they first came up with a declaration of sentiments that really wasn't particularly about voting. It was about a number of things, property rights, divorce laws. If you got a divorce at that time and you were a woman, you pretty much lost your children. You lost control of them. You just lost them. You didn't own your own clothing. So you pretty much were legally dead. Not really great. Frederick Douglass was at that convention, and I think this is a really wonderful thing to remember. The great abolitionist, the great orator, journalist Frederick Douglass, born into slavery, got up and said, you got to ask to vote. You can't vote, you can't do anything. They eventually got together in 1890 and formed NAWSA, N-A-W-S-A. 1878, they decided to focus on a national suffrage amendment. Women were getting the vote in some states or getting partially the right to vote. This is actually a map from 1920, this is what I could find. But you can see that in the western states, all the white states, women could, the white colored states, women could vote. The ones with little dots, including Tennessee, there was partial suffrage. You can vote in some elections, not others. It varied by state. And then the ones, kind of the old Confederacy, and then but then up into New England, there was not suffrage. So they were going for a federal amendment. So NAWSA was led by Carrie Chapman Catt, who came to Tennessee in 1920 and really helped push that 36-state final ratification through. Their approach was lobbying, shaping public opinion. Education. If we can get people to understand why women need the vote, then it will eventually lead to change and it will eventually pass. There was another group that was not affiliated with the NAWSA people, the NAWSA people. They were the National Woman's Party. These were women that had formed as a splinter group. They had originally been in NAWSA. And in 1913, they got really frustrated with this idea that lobbying for for you know, lobbying is going to change public opinion. Alice Paul, who was the leader, she was from New Jersey. She was a Quaker woman. She had been to Britain, where she had taken part in the British woman suffrage movement, which was a lot more militant. She and Lucy Burns and some other women formed what was called the Congressional Union within NAWSA, and then they split apart and they formed the National Woman's Party. They were called the militant suffragists. That's kind of a cliche, the militant suffragists. I study this time period, and I'll often run across in magazines some comment about militant suffragists. 1913, they started out. Woodrow Wilson, that's him in the corner in his top hat, was elected. And one of the first things they did is they had a big parade in Washington. Wilson reportedly got off the train at Union Station to come to his inauguration and said, "Where are all the people to welcome me?" And somebody said, "Well, sir, they're at the suffrage parade." You know, they're down watching that. It's a lot more interesting. One of the interesting things about, there were a number of suffrage parades, but one of the interesting things about them is that try to get at the women's self-confidence is they would have ambulances positioned every once in a while, because they thought, well, ladies can't walk that far. Without Wilson's support, Congress would not approve the suffrage amendment. And whether that's actually true, you know, we have three branches of government. Congress doesn't have to do what the president said, but I think Wilson was pretty good with getting what he wanted to pass passed. And anyway, the NWP women, rightly or wrongly, believed that he had the power to get the amendment through Congress. The amendment that had been introduced in 1878, written by Susan B. Anthony, eventually passed as the 19th Amendment, that said Congress shall make no law on the basis of sex to keep people from voting. So anyway, women began to pick at the White House demanding Wilson's support for suffrage. 1914, World War I began in Europe. As you know, we were not in it right away. Started in the other part of the world. The U.S. entered in 1917. Wilson had kept saying he was going to keep us out of it, and eventually that didn't work out. The government began to say that women needed to encourage their sons to join up. Women needed to send their sons to war. A good mother, a good American mother, would urge her son to go to war. So it was kind of like, you've probably heard of Rosie the Riveter in World War II, the big propaganda campaign to get women to take part in working in factories, working in shipyards. So women were supposed to send their sons to war, take war jobs, support the war in every way that they could, but they could not vote. And the NWP women had a problem with this. Started saying things like, "Wilson, you're just like the Kaiser." You know, they kind of made him mad. They thought he was hypocritical. You know, "You're urging us to send our sons to a foreign country, possibly die, very likely die, for freedom." So here they are marching in from their office. How long must women wait for liberty? So this went along, and it was not really bothering anybody for about 5 months. And then I think Wilson just kind of got tired of it. And he started arresting them, or having them arrested. So they took them to jail. They took them to book them. And in a woman named Doris Stevens wrote a really wonderful book. It's on the bibliography that I handed out, Jailed for Freedom, where she describes the first group of women, and they were down there and they were getting booked. And it's like, well, but what did they do? What did they do that was not legal? And they couldn't think of anything, so it took a really long time to get booked. They finally said, well, they were blocking traffic. So they charged these women with blocking traffic, and that was the kind of standing charge. And they were sent to this workhouse in suburban Virginia. It was condemned. There was no clean water. There was no clean bedding. They were held with criminals, including those with disease. Mostly they were pretty much upper middle class women, white women, and they were used to nice clothes, and that's just what they were used to. So, you know, this was made apparently out of kind of a blue ticking material, that kind of fabric, that thick, coarse material that a lot of times bed pillows are covered with. They did not have contact with their families. They did not have contact with legal counsel. There were rats in the DC City Jail. They were served crusty bread and soup with worms, and that's what was served. People who complained were beaten. They were put in isolation. And eventually they went on a hunger strike and they were force-fed. There was one night that the women called the Night of Terror. November 1917, about 40 guards with clubs were ordered to be 33 women, so more guards than women. One of the women was 73 years old, and some were as young as 16 or 17. One woman was hurled against an iron bed and knocked out, and her cellmate thought she had died and had a heart attack. And they could not write, they could not communicate. So there's no prison writing in the sense that maybe some of you have been hearing about this semester. They couldn't get much writing done because they had nothing to write with, nothing to write on. However, one family in Virginia found the person from their family who was in this group that was jailed, got a piece of toilet paper and found a little stub of a pencil and wrote a letter to her son. And the family kept the letter, and so it's in an archive in Virginia. But one of the things she says is, I've been kept from the privilege of incoming or outgoing mail. I'm now locked in a small cell and solitary. She says, two women who came in got 30 days. Others have gotten 6 months for the same charge of obstructing traffic. The women kept picketing. And they knew they were going to be sent to jail if they came, and they came and picketed anyway. In fact, lots and lots of women came and picketed. So they began to go public with the conditions they were kept under as part of their campaign for suffrage. Look, women are going through this, and it's for suffrage, so we need to vote. All we want is representative government. They compared the treatment to the abuses by the Tsar in Russia. Of course, around the same time, the Russian Revolution was happening. And so the abuses of the Tsar were in the public eye. There was one woman who actually was Russian and had come to America, and she was part of the American women's suffrage movement. And she actually said, it's worse than what I've known about in Russia. The women, I'm shortening things greatly to try to get to the other part. The women, they did win a hearing. A lot of them were released before they spent, you know, the 6 months there. And one person who's worth mentioning is Dudley Field Malone, the man up on the left, who was a top Wilson aide. He had campaigned for Wilson during Wilson's reelection campaign in the West where women could vote. And he said, you know, if you vote for Wilson, he'll help get women's suffrage in for the whole country. And Dudley Field Malone found out how the women were being treated, went to Wilson and said, I can't work for you. He gave up his whole political career. One thing they did, and this is getting to Sue Shelton White, our Tennessee NWP member, is that in February 1919, they were trying to get the amendment through Congress so that it could go to the states to be ratified. And the session was ending. They needed one more vote. and in the Senate. And Wilson refused to support them. Again, they really thought that Wilson could get them the votes if he wanted to. And he kind of had some lukewarm response. He said, well, I'll form a committee, and there'll be this committee, and they'll look into it. And he thought that that would make them happy, and it didn't make them happy. So they burned him in effigy. Do y'all know what burning an effigy is? Yeah, okay. So it's you take an image of the person and you burn it. It's like it's a symbolic act. So they had this little picture. It was actually a little cartoon. It was like a drawing. It wasn't even, I always thought an effigy had to be like a little figure, like a little doll you made, but no, a picture would do. They had a little cartoon of him that they cut out of a newspaper. And they put it in their fire, their watch fire. And Sue Sheldon White did that. So she was one of the two people who actually put the picture of Wilson in the fire. And this is, again, Doris Stevens. She describes the moment. The fire being kindled, the flames leaping into the air, Miss Sue White of Tennessee and Mrs. Gabrielle Harris of South Carolina dropped into the fire. In the urn, a figure of President Wilson sketched on paper in black and white, a sort of effigy deluxe, we called it, but a symbol of our contempt, nonetheless. And they went on a three-week cross-country tour giving speeches. They got out, of course, women back then sewed a lot. So those pillow-ticking things they had to wear in prison, their prison garb, their prison uniforms, got out their sewing machines, got a bunch of pillow-ticking, and made a whole bunch of replicas. And they would put them on purposely and give speeches. So they would kind of, I think this was, inscribing in a different way their a message of not being willing to be shamed. They had been given these very shaming clothes to wear and said, okay, we'll wear them publicly. And it, I think, kind of reclaimed their power in doing that. They called it the Democracy Limited. Their slogan was, from prison to people. And again, here's some more pictures on a speaking tour. People came out to see them. They were quite popular. They had won a lot of maybe notoriety, certainly fame, for their imprisonment. And it was covered. So I have a few slides with no pictures that are kind of how it was covered. The New York Times said, militant suffragists will attack President Wilson on three-week tour of country. Not exactly objectivity that would pass, I think, news writing today. But they did interview a number of people. So Mrs. Abby Scott Baker, who was one of the women interviewed, said, well, we intend to make it clear to the people that the administration is responsible for the fact that American women are forced to endure imprisonment. So their message, the way they inscribed or wrote the story of what had happened, was to go on a publicity tour. So the Atlanta Constitution said, well, the mayor will meet the suffrage prison special at the station, and he will warn them, he will issue a personal warning not to permit disloyal utterances and not to say anything against the president. Now, Sue Sheldon White, I'll tell you about her. She was from Hendersonville. She was a minister's daughter. One of her parents was Baptist and the other one was Methodist. And I forget which was which, and you know, I actually read two articles and one had it one way and one had it the other way. But anyway, one of her parents was Methodist, one was Baptist, and her father was a minister. And somebody said, well, you know, you have to make your wife convert. And he said, no. And he went and became a minister in his wife's church. So she had an upbringing that very much supported women's freedom of thought. She worked as a court reporter, made her own living. Her family didn't have very much money. She really didn't have very good schooling because she only had what was available to her up into maybe the eighth grade. Very bright. She became a court reporter. She was actually, I think, the first woman to be a court reporter in Jackson, Tennessee, and was very smart, very interested in law, and later in the 1920s became a lawyer herself. She was also editor of The Suffragist, and she wrote most extensively a long series of articles for the Montgomery Times in Alabama. And they said, she said, well, you know, really, we didn't do anything militant. We didn't do anything violent. We stood there with pickets, and we have a right to do that. We didn't even speak. We spoke our mind with words, but not violently. And she says, but it's been applied to us, and so we'll accept it, because it's a tribute to the spirit of the group of women who, with their wits, fought a battle against arbitrary power for liberty. But one of the things she said, Carrie Chapman Catt was really against these actions. She thought that it was going to make it worse, and that women would never get the vote, and that all these militant women should really stop it. She said, you know, to participate in the demonstration was the most difficult thing I was ever asked to do. She really didn't go picket up until, you know, pretty much until the end, when she really thought she needed to do it. She said, it's the greatest sacrifice I've ever made, and nothing but the deepest conviction could have moved me to it. So, did this make a difference? Our story has a happy ending, that, at least in terms of, you know, we can all vote. In terms of the suffrage amendment, passed both houses in May, and passed one house in May and the other house in June of 1919. It was ratified by the 36th state, Tennessee, in 1920. And NASA women said that the picketers made the situation worse and they should have waited, that it would have passed anyway. The NWP women argued that it would have just taken a lot longer. I actually imagine they were right. Women did not vote until France, until 1945, until after World War II, which I think is astounding. So, did it make a difference? I think it did.